So at this point, maybe you've been running a few A/B tests with Firebase, gotten the general hang of things, and now you have a few follow-up questions. Questions like, can I run multiple experiments at once? Can I use A/B testing along with BigQuery to analyze my results further? And what does this activation event thing mean anyway? Well, lucky for you, I've got some follow-up answers. Let's see if we can get to some of those on this episode of A/B Test Like a Pro. Okay, let's jump right into our first question. Can you run more than one A/B test at once? And if so, do you have to worry about people getting put into multiple experiments at the same time? So the answer is that yes, you can run more than one A/B test at the same time. In fact, I think you can run up to 5 at once. And the general idea is that for every A/B test that you're running, Firebase will basically re-roll the random numbers that it uses to determine which individual app instances get put into each experiment. So if you have two different experiments running on 5% of the population, you don't need to worry that like the exact same 5% of your users are going to be in both experiments. That's not going to happen. On the other hand, you're not going to get a completely separate group either. When Firebase grabs 5% of your population to put in experiment number 2, odds are that 5% of these people will already be in experiment 1. If my hands were a Venn diagram, it'd look like this. Now, in most cases, these groups will still be evenly distributed among your variants, so this shouldn't be too much of a problem, particularly if these experiments are unrelated. Like if one experiment is testing the flow of your sign up for our newsletter page, and another one is testing whether your game over screen improves user engagement, you're probably fine here. But if you are in a situation where one variant of one experiment could strongly influence one variant of another experiment, and you're pushing your experiments out to like a very high proportion of your population, it could mess with your results. So to use a somewhat contrived example, imagine I've got two experiments, one where I'm testing the background colors of my buttons, and another where I'm testing the text color of my buttons. Well, if I decide to push these experiments to like 100% of my population, about half the people in my red background color experiment are going to end up with unreadable buttons, and that's going to skew my results, right? Like I'm going to think, oh no, nobody likes this red background color. And that might not normally be the case if it weren't for the confounding influence of that other experiment. Now, like I said, most of the time this won't be an issue, but if you do find yourself in a situation like this, you're probably better off going with the multivariate trick we talked about in our second video and just make this a four-variant experiment, or run the two experiments one after the other instead of in parallel. Okay, next question. What's up with these activation events? So you might have noticed that when I created a remote config experiment, I kind of skipped over this advanced options section when selecting a goal. Well, hidden inside the section is a drop-down list that lets you select an activation event. So what is an activation event? Glad you rhetorically asked. The general idea here is that for the purpose of measuring an experiment, we won't count a user as being in the experiment until they first trigger this activation event. I mean, yes, they'll still be receiving whatever remote config parameters you've sent down to this variant, but they won't be included in any of your results until they first trigger the activation event. So when would you want to use this? Well, generally speaking, you want to do this when you think there's only a subset of your audience who's going to be exposed to your A/B test in the first place. For example, imagine that we're A/B testing our in-app storefront, and we want to find out which version is more likely to drive in-app purchases. But it also turns out that maybe a small percent of our users, like maybe like 5% or so, even decide to visit this store page in the first place. Well, in this kind of experiment, you'd want to make the visit store event your activation event. So the users who never visit your store simply wouldn't get counted in your experiment. Why does this matter? Well, suppose that due to some random chance, more people in experiment variant A decide to visit our storefront. Then out of these two groups, like 50 people make a purchase in variant A and 45 people make a purchase in variant B. Now, if we were to just look at the conversion rate from being in the general variant population to making a purchase, you might conclude that variant A did better by a little bit. It's got a slightly better conversion rate. But if we were to make the visit storefront event our activation event and just look at the conversions from there, you would come to a much different conclusion. This time it's very clear variant B is the better one because it did a better job of converting just the people who visited the store, and those are really the only users who count if you think about it. Honestly, another nice side benefit of adding these activation events is that the results end up looking a little more intuitive. Like even if we end up with exactly the same number of users visiting our storefront, seeing our users without an activation event shows us we have a conversion jump of like 0.1%, which feels kind of insignificant and lame. But if we were to rephrase this to like, well, out of the people who were actually exposed to your storefront, we have a bump of 2.5%, well, that feels like it's worth doing, even though proportionately, it's still kind of the same amount of improvement. Now, two caveats about these activation events. First, it doesn't count if a user has triggered this event sometime in the past before you started your experiment. So if you're experimenting on some advanced user feature, you might be tempted to add completed tutorial as an activation event to make sure you don't include any newbies in your experiment. But in practice, this wouldn't work because it would only count users who trigger the completed tutorial event while your experiment is going on. So all of your like regular expert users who have completed the tutorial weeks ago won't trigger this event and won't get included in your experiment, even though they probably should. The second thing is that activation events aren't a per session thing or a per hour thing, they're a for the lifetime of the experiment thing. Why does this matter? Well, let's imagine I've got an app where there are two ways to get users to sign up for my newsletter. One way is through a settings page, and another way is through a pop-up dialog that pops up occasionally asking our users to sign up. So let's say I'm trying to optimize this pop-up dialog through A/B testing, and I decide to add our pop-up dialog displayed event as an activation event. Now, does this mean that my experiment is only going to measure whether users have signed up through this pop-up dialog? Unfortunately, not quite. If my user dismisses the pop-up dialog and then later signs up through the settings page, they'll still be included in my experiment because they'll have encountered this activation event earlier. Now, granted, this will still help a bit. Like if we have users who never encountered this dialog, they'll never be included in our experiment, and that does help eliminate some of our noise. But don't expect this to be like a perfect filter. If I really just wanted to focus only on users who signed up through this pop-up dialog, I might want to record a completely separate signed up for newsletter through dialog event and look to optimize that. Okay, last question. What if we want to optimize for a goal that can't be measured through the Firebase console? Like right now, we have some very nice high-level goals, like optimizing user engagement or retention, as well as goals where we're looking to maximize the occurrence of an event. But not all experiment goals work that way. For example, let's say we've got some kind of puzzle game, and our lead game designer has determined that we want a player to win a level about 60% of the time to sort of be a nice challenge. Or maybe we want to make sure that each level in our game pays out the right amount of in-game currency, not too much and not too little. Well, this does seem like the kind of thing you would want to A/B test for by playing around with some gameplay variables. But the problem here is that there isn't a way to specify average payout is 20 coins per level as a goal in the Firebase console. But there is an alternative, and that's analyzing our experiment data in BigQuery. Now, I'm not really able to give you an entire breakdown of how to use BigQuery. That would be an entirely different video series, but you can at least check out this video somewhere in one of these info cards to get started. But for those of you who have a little BigQuery experience, here's how you'd analyze your A/B test results. When you create an experiment in A/B testing, behind the scenes, Google Analytics or Firebase will store a user property for this user called Firebase_exp_n, where n is the number of your experiment, and the value will be the index of the variant that they are in. So you can use this to analyze your results in BigQuery. So first, to find out the number of your experiment, go ahead and open up your original experiment in the Firebase console. So you see that number there at the end of the URL? That is your experiment number. Now the value of this Firebase_exp_experiment_number property will be set to 0 if your user is in the control group, 1 if they're in the next variant, 2 if they're in the variant after that, and so on and so forth. And of course it'll be null if your user wasn't placed into this experiment at all. So for example, let me go back and take a look at that Bingo Blast experiment from a few videos ago where they disabled ads. So I can see here at the top in this URL that it was experiment number 34. So I can query this experiment in BigQuery. Like let's maybe run a simple query here where we see how many display AdMob ad events were recorded for each group in my experiment. So what I can do here is grab the Firebase_exp_34 user property and the event name. And sure enough, it seems like I'm getting mostly display AdMob events when our user is in variant 0, which is our control group. Here, I'll add in a little case statement to make this clearer, and then we can count up all of our events. And as you would expect, it looks like the vast majority of display ad events are happening for users who are in our control group, not the ads disabled variant. Now, why isn't this other count exactly 0? To be honest, I'm not sure. There seems to be like one or two rogue devices out there that are reporting showing ads, but are still also reporting that they're in the no ads variant. They all seem to be running on Android Ice Cream Sandwich, so I suspect there might be some weirdness going on with some very, very old versions of Android. But you know, we're talking like less than 1% of devices out there, so I wouldn't worry too much here. And I can do other kinds of analysis as well. Here's a query where I'm breaking up the average score by whether you are in the no ads variant or not. That seems like a pretty big difference. And you might conclude that taking a break to watch some ads might be better for your long-term bingo playing. But it turns out with bingo scores, they can vary quite wildly based on how lucky you are. So in fact, if I were to switch to a different day, I can see that, well, here the control group is still doing better, but the difference is much smaller. And maybe that emphasizes an important point here, which is that a simple BigQuery query like this can give you averages, but it's not going to tell you if these differences are statistically significant. That's going to require a lot more math. Math that I don't really know. And so while all of this is super interesting, before you start querying all sorts of custom goals using BigQuery, you might want to take a step back and ask yourself, is this actually the goal I'm most interested in? Like, sure, our game designer has decreed that our puzzle game would work best if players win a level 60% of the time, but if you think about it, that's not our real goal, right? Like, our game designer probably came up with this number because they determined that at some point that a 60% win rate is the win rate that feels nice, like tough enough to be challenging, but not so difficult to be frustrating. And if you think about it, what our game designer is really looking to do here is improve our retention. And they've made an assumption, one that may or may not be true, that a 60% win rate is the best way to do it. And so what we really might want to do in our experiment is optimize for retention as our primary goal, which we can do simply using the Firebase console. And then, once we've figured out which group has actually retained better, maybe we go back to our results in BigQuery and find out what the win rate of our users are actually experiencing in the winning variant. So there you go, folks. Three questions you might have had about A/B testing answered. Got any more questions? Add them to the comments below. Maybe we'll do a follow-up video if we get some good ones. But in the meantime, go out there and have some fun with A/B testing in your apps and start making them better one experiment at a time. Or two at once, because you can do that. Yeah.